Hey there, I'm gonna talk to you today a little bit about novel writing. And I have written three novels. I'm gonna talk to you mostly about my books because that's what I know, that's what I've written. My first book came out in 2004 called Country Girl, City Girl. I don't have a copy with me, it's in my office and I'm stuck at home. Can't get into my office right now. But you can look it up online, you can see pictures of it. It was my first book and it was published, or a lot of it was written when I was in graduate school. And I think of it as a very traditional novel in that every chapter is approximately the same word count. It has a very linear arc. It's about a young girl who lives on a farm, who's very isolated, and she ends up meeting a girl from the city, and there's kind of a confused attraction between the two. So it's a young adult or older middle grade exploring female sexuality, friendship, and also living on a farm and going to a city. And it was, you can read more about that online. Another novel, the one that came after that, was called Me, Penelope. You can see this is the hardcover that came out, and then a few years later this is the paperback that came out. Very different covers. I actually did the illustrations for this cover, and I did not do the illustration for this cover. She does have a goldfish. It plays a very minimal role, but they decided to focus on that in the paperback. This one was written after grad school, several years later, and a lot of the chapters are very short, and there's some list writing. Whoops, that's the acknowledgement. It's first person, present tense. It's very much in this girl Penelope's mind. It's almost written as a journal. Some of the writing was actually taken from my journal when I was a girl. You can see she just lists, things that she wants. And I actually came up with this chapter when I was trying to figure out what my character wanted, and I thought I would just make a list of the things that she wants. And these were the six things that she wants. To get out of this town, get out of the prison they call high school, get away from my crazy mother. That was number one. Number two, to have sex before I leave home, because she's 17. That's what she wants to do. Three, to love someone, really, really love them, to be able to say I love you 1,000 times a day if I want without worrying that I am too much in love. Four, I want to get my driver's license and not freak out every time I get in the driver's seat. Five, to stop thinking about what happened 10 years ago. I was only six. And six, I want my mother to be happy. It may not seem like I want this since sometimes I can't stand my mother, but if she were really, truly happy, she might be more like the mother she used to be, and then maybe, just maybe, I could be happy too. So I had those six things that I listed that Penelope wants. She's called Lopey for short. And I ended up kind of just going through the novel with those six things in mind and trying to answer some of them, all of them. Not all of them are wrapped up. You can see this is a chapter about clogs. It's kind of a memory called New Clogs, about a time when she, Lopey, and her mother had the same, matching pair of clogs, and it was sort of a good memory. It's all a flashback. And then we go back to kind of the moment where she's running. And obviously, something happened 10 years ago that she has to work out. She's got a crazy mother. She's got some, love interests. And every chapter was titled with various titles: love, her thoughts on love. And again, this section is kind of just like a journal entry, just Lopey's thoughts on love. Love. They say love makes people crazy. Maybe that's why Viv is crazy. She is always in love. That's her mom, Viv. They also say that love makes you see the world differently. That's that where everything was once gray and dull, love makes everything radiant with splendid color. A girl who is truly in love leaves a trail of flowers growing in her footsteps. I keep checking for the flowers behind me, but all I see are the dead ants I've trampled. Love is not far from joy. Joy is not far from pain. Sanity is not far from madness. Good is not far from evil. I'm on the brink of all those things, teetering somewhere just in the middle, precariously balanced and constantly wobbling one from one side to the other. One push in either direction, and that's where I'll fall. Most days, it feels far closer to the hate, pain, mad, evil side than to the other. That was a bad day. And then goes to, what happens in the car? Charlie picks me up in his black Volkswagen Beetle on Saturday afternoon. We drive to the park and go for a walk. Charlie's one of the boys he tries to lose her virginity with, and it fails. This book was banned in Florida, in a county in Florida, because it has sex. Mostly, it was banned because the main character, 17-year-old Penelope Jaeger, wants to have sex. She does eventually, but she has like the most healthy sex ever. I really thought I was being responsible. I mean, she used a condom. It's a nice guy. It's a guy she's known, and she's trustworthy, and it's, it's like a little awkward. It's very safe. But they didn't care about that. They just were worried, because she had a desire. But it did fairly well, other than that. And it was really fun to write because it was very much like writing little journal entries, little snippets, and I kind of laid it out as, a series of little vignettes that some were very story centered and some were just kind of moments, some were backstory. And then my third novel came out a few years later. It's called Nothing But Blue. Came out in 2015, I think. And it's more of a magical realism. My first two books were definitely contemporary realism, girls sort of struggling with life and growing up. Nothing But Blue is also female, but it deals with memory loss. A girl wakes up on the side of the road. She doesn't remember anything. She's lost her short-term memory. She doesn't know how she got there. And all she knows is she has this drive to kind of get to the ocean, and she's in the middle, somewhere around like upstate New York. In my mind, it's not ever said in the book, but she ends up making a journey. She walks 500 miles from upstate New York to the coast, the East Coast, somewhere around New Hampshire or possibly Maine. It's present tense, and the challenge was that the girl who doesn't have a name, she's actually not named. She names herself Blue because that's the word she comes up with, but she can't actually remember her real name. That's part of her loss, or she can't say it. And the challenge was to how to write a story where a girl can't remember things. So everything had to be very present. It's a little haunting, and she ends up meeting a dog, a stray dog, that kind of magically aids her, helps her, sort of like a guardian angel. The goal is for her to get to the ocean. So that was the journey that needed to be concluded. The literal journey was going from, in state, to the ocean, to the sea, which is where she was originally from. That's where she had grown up. And then also to get her memory back, to sort of start to remember what happens. And slowly through the chapters, she gets bits of her memory back. She meets a lot of strange people along the way, some threatening, some very kind. She ends up hooking up with a group of train hoppers, and she lives with them in this area called Hobo Town for a week or so, and hops some trains and falls in love with a guy. She also has memories that sort of don't come to her, but because it's very hard to tell a story that's all present tense with a girl who doesn't have any memory, she can't have a flashback. I ended up doing some sections that are all flashbacks so that the reader could get a sense of what happened to lead up to the point where Blue is now, where she's on this journey. So, it would start, sections are called now, and these were in the present tense, in the moment. This is where the book starts. It starts with a chant that she hears in her head: all dead, no one survived, all dead. The words pound in my head like mini explosions going off again and again and again. All dead, boom, no one survived, boom, all dead, boom. I don't know what these words mean. I am not dead. I am here, so I have survived. The heavy fog dampens my clothes so that my cutoffs cling to my thighs. I touch the air gingerly, then grab at it as though I can hold on. I rub my fingertips together. They are wet and clammy from the humidity. I feel, therefore I must exist. But I'm not sure where I am. I've been walking since morning. I must be miles from wherever I began. It's afternoon now. And then, so we go with her kind of like trying to figure out where she is. A truck goes by and she runs away because she's scared. She hears a dog bark. She follows it into the woods. And then it would cut to a before section, which is all past tense. And it's not that she's remembering this now. It's just giving the reader a flashback to catch the reader up with this series of events that led to the disastrous thing that happened to cause her memory loss, that is why she's on the side of the road in nothing but cut off shorts and flip flops and having to walk home. So the before scenes are all in past tense. I thought romance would never happen to me. It was a white hot afternoon, unheard of even for July. And the past tense is very much about a boy that she met that kind of is not a good boy. He's not bad. He's just sort of a dick, really. And he's not very nice to her. But that is also sort of related to what happens and connects with the train hopper that she meets. But the worst thing that happens is something happens to her house and her parents, her entire family. I don't really want to spoil it for you, but she ends up discovering it and almost killing herself at the end, but then she doesn't and the dog saves her. Times the dog talks to her because she's alone most of this book, though she does meet a lot of people and she talks to them, but I felt like she needed a thing. It's hard to have a character all alone in a story without having them love something or learn to love something. And at first, Blue is very afraid of dogs. She doesn't like dogs. And she grows to trust this dog, a sort of magic dog, and it talks to her and it helps her. And you never really know if the dog is actually talking to her. And if those of you ever read Strays by Ron Kergy, he had a similar thing. I kind of took that from him, where his character would talk to animals, dogs and animals at the zoo. And I love that idea. And also Haruki Murakami is an author who I really admire. And he has a nonfiction book where he talks about running and he passes a field of cows and he hears the cows kind of talking to him. So I sort of mimicked that. And one of the things I did want to show you too was how I use storyboard to help structure my book. So again, the same thing I did, similar thing I did as with Me Penelope, I did with Nothing But Blue, was I had a series, like 100 little snippets of events, scene by scene, one scene where she's walking on the road, one scene where she hears the dog and she follows it into the woods, one scene where she's almost attacked by a group of men, one scene where she stumbles upon roadkill. There's my dog barking. She stumbles upon roadkill on the side of the road and she doesn't know what to do with it. It's some sort of mammal that's like partially dead, partially alive, and she has to actually kill it. There's a lot of tragedy. It's a harsh book in some ways. It's kind of a dark story, but it has a hopeful end. But anyway, so I would write those little scenes and I, collect them, and some of them, I don't know if you can tell here, but there'd be double spaces that kind of mark, double space that would sort of mark scene to scene. So yeah, that would be the start of a new scene. And I ordered all these scenes, what happened. And this is what I ended up doing. I don't know if you can see it very well. Maybe I'll stand up. So this is a large storyboard, one of several that I made for Nothing But Blue because I didn't know the order right away. And a lot of this book was about the structure and the order of things and when the reader finds out things. So I started with, for example, the beginning. And I just listed like a few things that I'd written that were important in that first scene. It's the first day. It's afternoon. A girl has been walking all day. She sits down to inventory her items. She has a key, flashlight, keychain, lifesavers. She can't remember her past. And what she needs is food and water. Then the second scene, which is also in the now, present tense, is the first night. The girl stops at a restaurant. She tries to eat old spaghetti, gets sick. She makes a box shelter to sleep in. A dog bothers her. And then I switch to a before scene. So you'd get the flashback 4 months ago, June, meeting Jake. And I didn't know this order at first, but that's how I ended up playing around with it. And these are just taped on. Sometimes I did them with sticky notes, I think the first one, but I could take them off. I could rearrange them. I could think, you know, what if I wanted this now scene to happen earlier? I wanted all of the now scenes to be chronological. And I wanted all the before scenes to be chronological. But where the before scenes would occur was very important. You know, how many now scenes do I have of her in the present, walking along, trying to find food, trying to find shelter, trying to find out what happened? How many of those now scenes could the reader handle before they needed a before scene, a sort of flashback scene? And I ended up with, I counted them all out. So I ended up with 30 scenes in the present, and I ended up with 11 scenes in the past. And so there's more now scenes than there are before scenes. And you can see in the beginning, I had two now scenes and then a before. And then I had two now scenes and then a before. Then two now scenes and a before. So I kind of kept that in a pattern. But then I had one, two, three, four now scenes, and then I had a before scene. And the before scenes get scattered a little bit more. I'm not even sure if this is the final order. But you can see how doing something like this, just taking every scene after they're written and giving a mere like couple of words about what happens, what's important in that scene, what do we learn, and then playing around with the order. That really helped me figure out, you know, the plot of the novel, because I hate plot, and I find that's the hardest thing for me to figure out, you know, is how am I going to take this girl, this character that I was very fond of and interested in her story and in exploring memory loss and in trying to explore healing, because her past is very tragic and she needs to do some serious healing. And those are things that I'm interested in. And, you know, relationships, like bad relationships, and how to understand what is an unhealthy relationship and how to maybe move on from that. Those are just sort of some bigger issues, but really the plot is what happens, you know, going from one spot to another. And that's where the storyboarding helped very much with figuring out that plot. I think that's all now. And this is Lisa Jahnklau signing off. Thank you very much.